Hallelujah. God is good. How many of you know that? All the time. That's what I want to hear. That's right. God is good all the time. Praise the Lord. We're excited about today. It's a little bit loud. It's okay. Today is Valentine's Day. We like celebrating Valentine's Day. And I think everybody does. And, you know, it's interesting that Valentine's Day was not invented by Hallmark. How many of you know that? Hallmark didn't come up with that. Back in around 296 AD, Rome had an emperor or leader, whatever you want to call him, that was trying to muster an army. The problem was everybody in his kingdom, they were falling in love, getting engaged and getting married, and you know, they had this law that they didn't have to go out to war for a year, you know, after they got married, so they're all getting married. And so he created a law that said nobody can get engaged or married until we say so. And so his name was Valentine, and that was his first name. Anyway, he was a priest. This priest named Valentine, but the emperor was, the priest was named Valentine. And so he just kept going against the rule of the emperor or the king or whatever they called him back then. And because he did that, he kept marrying people in secret. And then they would say, well, I can't go, I just got married. And so they arrested him and beheaded him. And because they did that, the lovers especially, people that wanted to be in love and get married and so on, they began what they call Valentine's Day. They named it after the priest who kept it going, kept love going. Kind of neat, isn't it? Anyway, it wasn't Hallmark. I always thought for sure it was Hallmark. You know, kind of bad, but it really wasn't. And that was pretty interesting. So praise the Lord. Let's begin in prayer today. Father, we are so thankful for the opportunity once again to be in your sanctuary of holiness, Lord. Your place, Lord, where you show up. Holy Spirit, have your way. Have your way today in each one of our hearts and each one of our lives. Lord, help us to keep our mind and our focus upon you. Lord, we do have a great dinner coming afterwards, but Lord, I thank you in the meantime, Lord, as we worship you. Lord, we're going to keep our focus on you and our worship on you today. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. So a couple of announcements real quick. This is a year of the local church. And so we are believing that the year of the local church means that God is going to do mighty things in the local church. There's going to be revival. There's going to be revival. Amen. It's going to not start in the mega churches, but the smaller local churches. And I really do believe that. And I'm just feeling it more and more in my spirit all the time that God's about to do something mighty. Amen. Praise the Lord. On we go here. We have a Bible study at 6:30 every Wednesday called Digging Deeper. We do that online, live. We set up a table up here, but we have room for people if they want to come. We just put the camera on myself and Pastor Cindy, and then we let other people, if anyone wants to join, they can, and we have a Bible study. And it's been a lot of fun. We've been studying faith for quite a long time. The Bible says in Hebrews 11:6 that without faith it is impossible to please Jesus. Amen. And this was one of the ones we did a couple weeks ago, and I had taken it off and forgot to. Faith and boldness is like cake and ice cream. That was a fun one, wasn't it? And it really is. So I mean, it doesn't say that in the Bible, but you know, you can make that inference of that. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And that's Happy Valentine's Day, dear Jesus. Amen. So I said Happy Valentine's Day to everybody else, but let's say Happy Valentine's Day to Jesus. You know, we're talking about how much we love a person when we give a Valentine. How many people love Jesus here? Yeah. Hallelujah. Amen. So we're going to love Jesus today as we worship him. So let me shut this one off and turn the other one on. Yes, yes.
Oh, yes. Our normal greeter is not here today. She is actually in the hospital. My mother, she's usually my greeter. She has been with us for about as long as I've been preaching. Anyway, and here, Yeah, so praise the Lord. God is good. Anyway, she is in the hospital, but she's doing better. She wasn't doing too well yesterday. She had another procedure. That'll be the third one. They found that she had a bleeding ulcer, which was affecting everything else. And so they repaired the other two bleeding ulcers that they found yesterday. So I'm still in the hospital on Tuesday, I believe. She got another heart graft, getting rid of an 80% block in her heart. And so there's been a lot of things going on with her. She's anxious to be back in church. She was here last week, and about 2 weeks before, she had passed out or fell unconscious or whatever. And so the ENTs took her up, and they found that she had a valve in her heart wasn't working. So they put... they gave her a heart monitor, she started feeling better, and sent her home. In church here Sunday, a heart monitor, and the emergency or hospital called and said, your heart monitor is not working right, or you're not working right. We're showing that you're going all over the place, so you need to get here to emergency right away. And she says, I'm in church. I'll be there after church. I appreciate that. She was standing worshiping. She was doing good, so... Anyway, she's gonna recover, amen. Yeah, no, we expect that. So I did want to just say that, let you know that's what's going on with her. Praise the Lord. We've been there every day there, so
she's great. Appreciate everyone.
Yes, we do appreciate everyone's prayers. Her name is Joanne. Let's stand. We got a few oldies today. I'm talking about not me. I'm talking about the songs. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God is good.
send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence, from the shadow into your radiant. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. We worship you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, let there be light upon this nation. Lord, bring truth and light to this nation, Lord. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed. Renew, flowing from the grace that I found. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be swept away by the power of your love. Oh, hold me close, let your love surround me, bring me near. And as I wait, I'll rise up.
With his power, he has raised.
desire to praise our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. This one, this song, some of you may have heard it, you may have not. The more I seek you, the more I praise you. And this song is not a love song for anyone but Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's worship him as we sing this. Let's sing it right to him. Amen. The more I see, the more I seek you, the more I find you, the more I find you, the more I love you. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming. The more I seek you, the more I find you, the more I find you, the more I love you. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe through your heart. Love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe through your heart. More than I can stand, I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe through your heartbeat. This love is so it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace. Bless you, Jesus, I melt in your peace. Oh, Jesus, I melt in your peace. Oh, it's so overwhelming. It's so overwhelming. Let us melt in your peace. Let us melt, let us melt, let us melt in his peace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh Jesus. Oh Jesus. We love you, Jesus. So good, Lord, we love you now. Yes, Jesus, oh Jesus, we love you, Jesus, and we praise you, and we worship you.
today. Let's just worship Him. Just worship Him for a moment. Hallelujah. We worship You, Jesus. Oh, we worship You. Yes, we worship You. Oh, we worship You. Oh, Jesus. We praise Your name. Oh, we praise Your name. For You alone are worthy of all praise. We honor You. We honor You. We honor You.
Body to be totally restored
totally restored. Her sight become better than it's ever been. 20/20 vision right now. We come against that macular degeneration and we call it macular regeneration right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We command that heart to be healed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there anybody here today that needs prayer? Anyone at all? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Pastor Cindy was saying I should explain what happened there in the spiritual realm. But the Bible says that if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you have 9 gifts of spirit residing within you. One of those is speaking in tongues. That's a spiritual language. And then there's always interpretation in the church anyway. You're praying at home. That's a different thing. It's a spiritual language that you can pray on. There's different kinds of tongues, the Bible says. So, anyway, that's what that was. And so, Pastor Cindy.
Okay, so I share a verse every week. I did this for a couple reasons. Well, number one, God put it in our hearts, my heart. Pastor Dave agreed. But I had trouble reading the Bible in my younger days because I was slightly dyslexic. I struggled with comprehension and I struggled with reading. And I really don't deal with that too much anymore. Not that aspect of it. There are other things I can. When Dave and I heard a saying years ago, and we wish we had it a few years sooner. When I say, turn to your left, he says, which left, your left or my left? Because it seems to be a big thing with people who deal with that. But anyways, the verse is meant to, which one is the next one? That one? There we go. The verse today is John 3:16. And when God gave me this verse, I figured I'd be speaking on the verse. Only slightly. All right, so what I would like you to do is to read it with me. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Okay, I didn't quite finish what I started saying. Is yes, I struggled with comprehension, but I want to show you how easy it is to break the Bible down. If you look at it as one verse at a time, it changes your life. Okay, so what I'm going to be talking about real quickly is foundational verses. That verse is a foundational verse. Okay, you don't build a house without a foundation. You don't build any kind of structure you want to stand up and stay without a foundation. So what does that mean to us? This is a foundational verse. Okay, so we could start with the story, we won't stay there long, about the man who built his house upon the sand and the man who built upon the firm foundation. Okay, I guess you can tell which one was on the sand. That's pretty easy. Okay, so here's what I want you to see. Every verse you memorize, every verse you learn is like one brick building your foundation stronger. And when you realize that, it changes the desire to want to learn. It increases the desire. It just changes it from being a word to being life. Okay? I want a strong foundation. And so, and like I've told you, there are 52 verses. Weeks in a year. You learn one verse a week, you learn 52 in a year. Okay? So don't worry about that though. Concentrate on saying one verse over and over and over. You don't have to memorize it. You don't have to set out, okay, I gotta learn this verse. No. Just say it over and over and over. And as you repeat it, it will become personal. It'll become real to you. Okay, We got another house not built upon a firm foundation. Actually, it may have had a firm foundation, but it didn't have a firm environment. That's a really, really good thought right there, Pastor Dave. I like that one. Okay, so anyways, I haven't even looked at my notes. The picture of the sand, the man who built upon the sand, and the other house, that is from Matthew 24 through 27. I just wanted to point that out real quick. I'd like to give you where my references are from. Moving on. This one, this picture caught my eye because if you look, there's mortar on both sides where they tried to patch it. Very, very interesting. What would this be? This would be someone who has some word, but a disaster hits and they don't know what to do and they fall apart and they don't know how to get up and sometimes they turn away. They might speak a little word, but they're not really strong. They have to go in and find the problem. They have to deal with that so they can move on. And this one, now we've discussed that you're a house, essentially, for the Word of God. You are God's, well, the scripture says, you are the temple of the living God. Okay, our body is a house. I want you to understand that every brick you put in there increases your faith. Your faith is your foundation. You've got a little house, you've got a big house. Little house, little scripture. Big house, more scripture. And you can go on and on and up till you get to the skyscraper, which is massive scripture. Cool, okay? But what does the scripture do? It increases your faith. It's not there for anything else other than to increase your faith. And that's what I want you to see. Okay? So, I don't want the little house. The little house, nah. It's okay. But I'm going for bigger. You know why? Because I expect to lay hands on you when you need prayer and have results happen. So, that's a nicer house. Okay? But I want to show you something a little closer to what I'm believing for. You see the lake out in front? That's not quite the one. I've chose this in a hurry, but this represents what I want. I want the nice house on the lake. That means I want great faith. Not so I can boast, not so anyone can boast, but so you will see the power of God flowing through us, through me, through us as a team. You will see the result. I want you to understand, when you speak the word of God, things can happen, should happen, very good, and will happen. But the only way that will happen is if you plant your seed, which would be put your bricks in, one verse at a time, build that strong foundation, and, I just want to really encourage you this week to think about it. What kind of a foundation are you? Are you a small house? Are you a big house? Do you want to go bigger? Are you adding your bricks? Are you building your foundation? I want you to move forward. And then, when you look at John 3:16, now you see this is a foundational verse, and God loves me. In fact, everyone say that with me. God loves me. Point to yourself this time. Ready? One more time. God loves me. There you go.
Thank you, Pastor Cindy. Enjoyed that today. That was a lot of fun.
What? Yeah.
Praise the Lord. God is good all the time. Amen. I'm going to be continuing with last week's message, but before I do, I want to go to a verse that kind of describes today. Amen. So let's go here. The message today is walking in favor and victory. The first, this verse, John 13:34. Jesus said this. He said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Amen. And so, Bible tells us we need to love one another. Now, a lot of people say, yeah, there's a few people I love. No. We need to love everyone. And you know, in this day and age that we live in right now, and things have been going on, there's a lot of animosity out there, a lot of division. And that should not be that way, especially for Christians. doesn't matter what someone says to us. It matters what we say, how we react. Amen? As Christians, we are supposed to love one another. And it also says that we're supposed to love our enemies. And those who despitefully use you and come against you and so on. And that can be difficult. But you know what? We need to be reminded of that. I think I've been reminded everybody of that for the last several weeks, maybe several months. But we need to remember who we are. Who we are. It doesn't mean we don't stand up for what we believe in. We should. But also, we also need to love one another. Because people that are don't think like we do doesn't mean that they're terrible people. It just means they don't have all the information. You know, and I used to, years and years ago when I was a young preacher, I used to judge people all the time. Bible says, by your, I love that scripture that said, I used to love it, by their fruits you shall know them. I figured I had it right. If they have rotten fruit, rotten person, right? Just makes sense. But then the Lord showed me one day that that's not how it works. And through vision, he showed me that I was wrong. And I was judging people. And, you know, he told me, he says, you know, you're looking at the outside, but I look at the heart. Amen. And so we, rather than thinking everybody's wrong when they come, when they have a different opinion than us, and when they come against you, try to find out what's going on with them. Maybe they're hurting. Maybe they just haven't got all the information. You know, Valentine's Day is a good day to remember that. And remember to just love one another. Amen. And realize some people are going through some really rough times. And other people are still in fear. There's a lot of fear out there. A lot of fear. And they don't know how to get out of it. But you do. So share with them the author that can defeat fear. God is love. The Bible says perfect love casts out all fear. God is perfect love. Share him with them so they can get rid of that fear as well. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm not going to stay on that because I want to get into my message, but I did want to bring that out. And what we're talking today is how to live in faith and victory. Last week we talked about living in God's economy. We compared the economy we live in right now that's kind of, you know, taking a plunge. And then we were talking about God's economy that never takes a plunge. You may disagree with me, but it never does. And if you're trying to live in God's economy and you're taking a plunge, then you're not living in his economy. Amen? Because God's economy is good. Amen? And it's great for us. And he has so many things for us if we can just receive. Usually what the problem is, it's not God. It's our receiver. I was talking about Cindy's dad a few days ago with someone, and we were talking about how he had a ham radio. Anybody remember ham radios? Yeah, some of us do. Most of us, I guess, are older crew here. Yeah, we remember ham radios. There aren't very too many young people in here that would remember them. But ham radios, you know, you could reach people all across the world with those things. And if you had a good receiver. You had to be able to have a good receptor too, but signal, but you also had to have a good receiver. If you have a good receiver, then you could receive people's people trying to reach you from all over the world. It was pretty awesome. And I sat with him times when he did reach people in other parts of the world. It was pretty neat. But, you know, so many people tried that out, said it doesn't work, I can't get anybody. I had a bad receiver. Do you have a bad receiver? I guess that's the question. Maybe it's not God. Maybe it's our receiving that's not working so well. Amen? Because God wants us to live in favor and victory. Amen? He wants us, every battle that we fight, we should have victory. We should win. I was working for a gentleman on Lake Charlevoix here a while back, a couple years ago. Maybe 3 years ago now, I've lost track. But anyway, he had this huge his property. It should have been a yard, but instead it was all these juniper bushes, you know, cedar bushes, and they were packed together on his whole property, all of his frontage right up to the lake. And so he had no place he could, you know, put out a chair or have a barbecue or anything. And so I was hired to take out these these bushes. And so I was thinking about one by one, because they weren't that easy to do. Anyway, I was working on it, and we got a stop work order because he hadn't gotten the proper permit. And they said, you cannot take those bushes out because this is, Lake Shovelboy, what do they call that? Anyway, it was wetland or whatever. It really wasn't wetland, but because it was close enough to the lake, they wouldn't allow him to take it out. They said, you're gonna goof up the lake. There's gonna be soil going in there and so on and so forth. And so they stopped the project. And so he said, are you gonna keep on going? I said, I can't, project stopped. I said, what are you gonna do about it? And he says, I'm gonna win. I never lose. I win every battle. He wasn't saying that as a Christian. He was just saying that as a person. And he did win. He won. Because he said he was going to, he did, and we got it started and finished it. But here's the thing. Christians should win every battle that the enemy brings against you. You should win every battle. And if we're not winning every battle, then we're missing something. We're missing part of our armor, or we're just not, like Pastor Cindy said, we don't have enough bricks. You ever hear somebody say that person's one brick short? Maybe we need some more bricks, amen? Anyway, we need a better foundation if we're not winning these battles. We can all win every battle if we just get into the Word and find out everything He has for us. By the way, we have some books in the back. I think they're back there still. It's called In Him. And those are free. Yeah, by the offering plate. We have a lot of other things that, yeah, there you got holding up there. It's a blue and a light blue book. This is a little one. But we have one for everybody where they are free. Yes. And so if you haven't got one yet, please pick one up. It's called In Him. It doesn't have all the scriptures, In Him scriptures, because there's like 300 of them. But in that book, there's just, maybe 25, 30. But those are really good, important things. And so if we know who we are in Christ, wow, it is amazing. I feel like this last year, and I know it was a rough year, but we feel like we grew more in the Lord this last year than we have in many, many years. We feel like our faith has gone over the top. Amen? And also, financially, we did better this last year than we have almost any year since we've been married, maybe than any year. So, all I'm saying is, we can win every victory. And we did. We won every battle. We had a victory every time. Amen? Hallelujah. So I got this question. How would your life look if you were surrounded all day and every day by God's favor? How different would things be if doors opened for you and you walked through each one covered with God's favor? Would your actions and attitudes in every situation be any different? If you knew beyond any doubt the success lies ahead, because you are one of God's favorites, would you find the courage to lay down your anxieties and fears? Well, of course you would. If you knew God was walking arm in arm with you and you couldn't fail, it wouldn't matter what was in front of you. You're walking along and all of a sudden there's this bog in front of you. It's no big deal. But He's going to walk across it on top. Not in it, on top, right? You wouldn't even begin to think that's not going to happen. You would know it's going to happen because you've got God's favor and He's with you. And you know that the truth of what I just read is there. That is truth. The Bible says God surrounds us with favor. Let's go to Ephesians. Ephesians 2:8. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Let me talk about that for just a moment. It's one of those foundational scriptures, right? For by grace you have been saved through faith. That not of yourself, it is the gift of God. Now that's the New King James. I think in the King James it says not by works. Okay? We're saved by grace, not by works. Amen? Not by what we can do. Not by and you can do 100 different things really good. But in 1 Corinthians 13, I think it's verse 7, it talks about, even if, or two or three maybe, it says, even if you have all the faith in the world, so that you can move mountains, if you don't have love, it's worth nothing, right? So, You can do great things. You can give everything you have to the poor, it says. But if you don't have love, it's no good. And so what I'm saying is, favor is God's grace, right? God gives us grace. Grace is not something that, it's not mercy. Let me explain that really quick. It's not mercy. Great mercy is not getting punished for something you deserve, where grace is getting things that you don't deserve, like salvation. You don't deserve it. You can't pay a high enough price for your sin. It's just not possible. I don't care if you had Donald Trump's money. Wouldn't make any difference. If you got every one of these trillionaires out there, or billionaires, whatever they are, and took all their money and said, okay, God, I got enough now to pay for my sins, he would say, nah, no, not even close. Because it isn't. But by grace, it's grace we've been saved through faith. And that under is not of yourself, it is a gift of God. Amen? Hallelujah. Many Christians believe that they need to somehow earn the favor of God. So we're talking about favor again, okay? Not talking about salvation now. But you can't get God's favor without earning it, without doing things for it. Like, you know, how much you give or how many things you do for people or whatever. You can't earn God's favor. It's just like salvation. You cannot earn it. God's favor is given to you because he loves you. Simple as that. It's not because of how great a Christian you are. It would be nice, wouldn't it? If we could just do this, and then we're going to get God's favor. Those other people, sorry about them, but you know they don't get it. I've worked for it. No, you can't work for it. It's coming because God loves you. Amen? Praise the Lord. Grace is favor. As a matter of fact, the word favor is charis. Charis. Anybody ever heard the word charismatics? We here are charismatics, right? What does that mean? It means that you are full of God's power, his love, his victory, his joy. You know, you're full of the gifts of the Spirit. You are full of God. That's charis. Amen? That's the word favor also. It means favor. Favor. And when you look at charis, you'll find that word in there. Favor is what charis is. It means you can't do it by yourself. Amen? Favor is from God. Amen? It was God's grace at work in your life that enabled you to be born again. It was his grace, not your works. From that moment, from the moment you stepped into that new life, the moment you made the Lord Jesus Christ God, his favor began working nonstop on your behalf. Now, you may not feel that way. So what do you mean, you're working nonstop on my behalf? You know, when you first get born again, and you ever, most of you have been born again, anybody here not born again? Anyway, you may remember when you first gave your life to Jesus Christ, how God did everything for you. The Bible says we're baby Christians at that point. Remember when you were a baby? I hope nobody here remembers that. I mean, I don't. But I've been told, when I was a baby, my mom did everything for me. Amen? She fed me. She clothed me. She helped me. She carried me to places. She did everything for me. She provided for me 100%. Why? Because I was a baby. When you're first born again, you're a baby. And God does everything for you. It is incredible. But those babies get older. They begin to walk and say no. They say no first, right? And they've got to learn at that point. They've got to learn that they can't say no all the time. In fact, they should be saying yes, ma'am, right? And they begin to learn that they've got to do some things on their own. It was kind of nice when they didn't have to. You know, in some families, when you know, the baby is no longer the baby, another baby comes along, oh, they don't know what to do. It discourages them so bad. What do you mean, I got to do it myself? Well, you're not the baby anymore. Well, I want to be the baby. Get rid of the other baby. And, you know, sometimes we feel that way. Like, Lord, it was so good while you were taking care of me. He says, well, I'm teaching you to take care of yourself. If you realize in these scriptures are all kinds of promises from God to help you take care of yourself. Luke 10:19, it says, behold, I give you authority over serpents and scorpions. We're talking about demons. And all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. I give you authority over that. Amen? He gave it to us, right? There's a lot of other scriptures too. And so, because of that, God has given us the power to be able to do the things that we need to have happen in our lives sometimes. Amen? And so, it's nice to know that. He gave them to you, not because you earned it. Again, it's grace. It's favor. Amen? Hallelujah. Being born again was just a starting place for His favor to pour out on you. And He will pour out grace and more favor to you every moment of your life if you'll receive it. You've got to learn how to receive it. Psalm. I like this. This is one of David's Psalms. I like it. Psalm 5, 12. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. By the way, everyone here, if you're born again, you are righteous. You may not feel righteous. You may feel like anything but righteous. But the Bible says if you are born again, you have the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So we are righteous through Jesus, not through ourselves. The Bible says our righteousness is us filthy rags. So it's Jesus' righteousness is on us. When God looks at us, He sees Jesus. Amen? So, O Lord, you will bless the righteous. And with favor, you will surround him. With favor, you will surround him as with a shield. So let's say this together. With favor, you will surround me as with a shield. Does everybody say that? With favor, you will surround me as with a shield. God wants to surround us with favor. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So how do you receive God's favor? Well, by faith. How do you get born again? By faith. You just believe that what God said is true. He said, Jesus said, if you receive me, then you'll have eternal life. Then you'll have eternal life. All they had to do was believe that He was the Lord, Savior, and they would have eternal life. Wow. Make Him Lord. Not just believe it, but make Him Lord. Amen? You have eternal life. You got it by faith. And you get favor by faith as well. All you have to believe that you have favor, that God is trying to pour favor on you, and you'll begin to receive it. And believe me, I've seen that many, many times. When you start believing that God wants you to win every battle and every victory, you're going to start winning every battle and every victory because of His favor that's on you, not because of how great you are, how smart you are. You know, I have this saying, it's called paralysis of analysis. I've met some very, very intelligent people at times, and the most intelligent people I meet have the hardest time receiving from God because of how intelligent they are. They figure, I can do it on my own. Or I can earn it, you know. It doesn't make any sense that God wouldn't want to use my great intelligence. Sure, He wants to use it. But you're not going to get favor and grace and mercy because of your great intelligence. Amen? Paralysis of analysis. Amen? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, so you've got to believe and receive everything He wants you to have. But some people say, well, Pastor, you don't understand. I don't deserve it. Well, you got that part right. You don't deserve it. You absolutely don't deserve it. You never will deserve it. But that's okay. When you finally realize that you don't deserve it, that's when you're going to get it. Amen? When you think you deserve it, you won't get it. When you realize you don't deserve it, then you start seeing it. Amen? Hallelujah. Favor is grace. Amen? 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, "When the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show Himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is perfect toward Him, herein thou hast been foolishly. Therefore, from henceforth thou shalt have war." So that last part doesn't matter, but the first part is what we're looking at, right? "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show Himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is perfect toward him. What does that mean? That means your heart has Jesus Christ in it. You know, the Bible says we receive Jesus Christ into our heart, right? Not him, actually, because, you know, the Bible says he's seated at the right hand of the Father, but the Spirit of God. We need to have the Holy Spirit inside of us. And when our heart has God in it, when our heart has God in it, when our heart is filled by his word and by his love and his presence, then that means our heart is perfect for him. And he's going through all this, looking for people. That the heart is not about other things, but about him first. And when he finds those people, he says he's going to show himself strong or mighty on behalf of them. Not just, you know, we're talking about someone lifting barbells. We're talking about someone that's mighty, that can vanquish every enemy from you, that can make you win every battle. And that's what it says there. And it's true. It is true. I've had so many times over my life where I couldn't have done it myself. An angel would show up and take care of me. I know it sounds strange, but angels do exist. They're real. The Bible says that they are ministering servants for the saints of God. And ministering servants, most ministering servants have helped me many times over my life. I'm not just exaggerating or saying anything. It's very, 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 very true. Amen. So, we need to understand that God will help us. If we can't do it through faith, then God will show up and help us. Amen. Hallelujah. One quick story on that. I was a missionary up in Canada, up in Manitoba, Canada, and it's cold up there. I think it's cold here the last few weeks. This is nothing. It was usually close to 40, 50 below zero all the time. And I pick up people from the reserve. Don't call them reservations there. There are reserves up there. I fill the bus up with all these Soto Indians, and we take them to church. Get them saved, get them excited about Jesus, and take them back home. But one day, in the middle of taking them, it was a Wednesday night, it was dark, taking in the church, and it was blowing like crazy. The wind was blowing hard, and it was already probably 35, 40 below zero, and that wind's blowing. Can you imagine what the wind chill was? And all of a sudden, the bus stopped. It just stopped. The motor stopped. How many of you know when a motor stops, the heat stops? And none of these Soto Indians had coats. They were very poor. But I picked them up in a warm bus. I took them to a warm building. They got back into a warm bus. They went back to their warm home. But this day, that wasn't the case. And so I got out very quickly. I had a warm coat on. I got out and opened up the hood. And the spark plug had blown out of one of the cylinders. It was still attached to the spark plug wire. And also, I think I can get it back in. I didn't lose it, at least. So I took out the spark plug wire and tried to turn it in by my hand, but it stripped the threads and it wasn't going in. It wouldn't stay in. And every time I tried to start it, it blew back out. After trying to do that for about 10 minutes, everybody in that bus were shaking badly. They were going into hypothermia. Now, I was a newspaper man, okay, for years and years. So my mind went to this headline article. You know, missionary kills 60 people. And this is not good. I said, God, I need a miracle. I can't do this on my own. And just then, this little short guy, angels aren't always tall, by the way. He was a short guy. He was a short guy. He was probably my height. But that was short, you know, nevertheless, compared to what I expect angels to be. But anyway, he came walking up. He was out for a walk, a leisurely walk with his little white Michonne dog, probably. It was the one we have now. Anyway, they were out walking down these railroad tracks. The wind was blowing like crazy. And he said, out for a walk, right? And he comes up to me and says, and I didn't even see him coming. You know, I could see him a long ways. And all of a sudden, he was there and he said, can I help you? I said, told him what was going on. I said, I need a spark plug wrench. And these spark plugs weren't even the normal size of a spark. They were smaller. You know, they were weird ones. I said, I need a spark plug wrench. No, these spark plugs. I got to get this spark plug back in. in the bus before these people freeze to death. He reached in his pocket and pulled out the spark plug wrench I needed. I put that spark plug in, and we had heat, and they were all saved. And I turned around and gave it back to him. He was gone. I had that for a long time. I don't know what ever happened to it. I'm telling you, God wanted to show himself strong. How do you have those? You have a perfect heart toward him. And that's you. That can be you. He wants to surround you with favor, as with a shield. Amen. Hallelujah. Sadly, many times we are slow to receive God's favor. We think we're waiting on Him when He's actually waiting on us to receive. Doesn't have to be that way. I've gone to pray for people before, and they tell me, especially the hospital, they say, well, you know, I think God's trying to teach me a lesson here, so, you know, I don't know if I should let you pray for me. The crazy thing about that, they're in the hospital. They're letting the nurses take care of them. They're letting the doctors take care of them. But they don't want a preacher to pray for them. They must figure my medicine is a whole lot better than the doctor's medicine, I guess. I don't know. But, you know, I've lost track of how many times I've heard that. And not just in the hospital, sometimes out of the street. I ran into one person one time that was blind. I think we might have ran into somebody that was blind too. Cindy and I used to go out on the streets all the time. And the guy was blind. I said, let me pray for you. And he said, no, 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 no. I said, why not? I will lose my disability. I think he wanted sight. I don't know. Just me. People are slow to receive from God sometimes because of some crazy, crazy ideas. We were in a Bible study one night, and this, you know, we were talking about God's healing power and how He wants to heal people. And this one lady got very upset and says, no, God doesn't want to heal people. Some people, He wants them to die. I said, what do you mean? Well, I don't know who it was. She knew somebody that was the best Christian she ever met in her life, and God didn't want to heal her. He just let her die. He wanted her to die. I said, that's not true. That's not God. There's some things you're missing. Sometimes what happens, and we were talking about that earlier, sometimes people are thinking wrong because they don't have all the information. They may have a Bible in front of them, but if they're not reading it, if they're not studying it, it doesn't mean that they're going to have a victory. It doesn't mean that they're going to get healed. Jesus Christ did a lot of things for us, including dying on the cross and rising from the dead so we could have eternal life. It's available to everybody, but not everybody goes there. And it's not because He doesn't want them to. The Bible says He's not willing that any should perish. It's not His will that anybody should perish, but that all would have eternal life. And yet not everybody will receive Him. They don't have all the information. Somebody like you and I didn't come along when God said, hey, go talk to that person. We were talking about Bible study this last week about how compassion goes along with love. Compassion and love. So when you're walking along and you see somebody that's hurting, you can tell they're hurting. Maybe they're in a wheelchair, maybe there's something else going on, and your heart is filled with compassion for them. The right thing to do is walk right past, right? Kind of look at it and say, "Oh, I'm sorry for them." That is not the right thing. Yet it's what 99.9% of Christians do. We were watching somebody praying for people the other day on television. He came across a guy in a wheelchair. What usually happens? Bless you, bless you, bless you. I appreciate that. But what happened to our boldness? What about our boldness? We need to be bold. We need to say, God's power flows through me. You're sitting there. You need God's power. Rise up. We don't do it. And it could be somebody that's just hurting. You might see in the storm, you think, wow, yeah, man, I got compassion for him. But, you know, faith works by love, also by compassion. But, you know what? This is a store. You know, it's a long place, is it? It's probably the very right place. I'm sure that everybody Jesus prayed for wasn't in the church. Amen? Most of the time, he didn't meet him in the church. God can work anywhere, anywhere. And he works through us, through us, through our love and through our compassion for them. God's love flows through us. The Bible says, out of our belly shall flow rivers of living water. Living water. What's living water do? It refreshes you. It heals you. It raises you up. If someone's dying in the desert, you know what they need? They need water. Someone is dying from a disease. What do they need? They need the power of God to touch them and flow through them. We got that. It's inside of us. If you belong to Jesus Christ, you are an ambassador for him, and he's put all of his power and authority in you to be able to do these things. John 14, 12. And you've heard it a lot of times. The thing Jesus said, if whoever believes, the things that I have done shall he do also, because I go into my Father. Well, you're saying that I can lay hands on the sick and they'll recover? Absolutely. You're saying that I can raise the dead? Absolutely. You're saying that I can move mountains? Absolutely. Absolutely. Whatever God did, you're saying I can feed 5,000 with 2 fish and 5 loaves? Absolutely. If you believe. If you believe. Absolutely. The Bible says it. It's true. Jesus said it. Red letters. It's true. We like that red letter thing, don't we? If it's red letters, we know it's Jesus. Praise the Lord. God is good. God wants us this year to make a difference. You know, we had a great year last year. I know there were a lot of horrible things going on. We had a good year. This year can even be better. You say, well, wait a minute. We don't have the same precedent. It doesn't matter. We had the same God. He didn't get voted out. Not that I know. He's still there. He's still on the throne. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he didn't get voted out anywhere. He's still on the throne. He's still our God. He still loves us. And he still gives us authority. He wants us to be his ambassadors. We can be them. Amen. This could be your best year ever. Amen. Especially spiritually. If you just learn to receive what God has for you. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to pray in this service. Then I'm going to talk to you a little bit about how we're going to do our dinner. So just stay in your seats for just a little bit. Father, we thank you. And today, as we end this service, Lord, that we're not ending our fellowship with you. Holy Spirit, go with us wherever we go today. Go with us every day. Help us to seek you every day. Help us to want to be with you every day. If there's anybody out there today that has never given their life to Jesus Christ, you've never really experienced the God that I'm talking about and the power of God I'm talking about, you can. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Today is your day to receive Jesus Christ. You may be a very religious person, but religion won't get you to heaven just like works won't. You've got to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord, as your Savior. He wants you in his family. If you want to do that today, I pray that you pray after me. I'm going to say a few words. You say those few words and we're done. You're going to be a new creation in Christ. If you're doing it because you really want to and you really want to change, you will become a new person. The Bible says that. So anybody that would like to, you can join with me. Just join with me, even if you're born again, so everybody can pray this together. Father, we thank you right now for your power. Lord, I thank you for Jesus Christ, who gave his life for me to forgive me of all my sins. He washed them away. And then after he gave his life, he rose again to give me eternal life. I receive you, Jesus, right now into my life. I want to experience your power in my life. I want to have victory and favor on my life. And I want to serve you every day for eternity. If you prayed that prayer, you are now a new creation in Christ. We have some things that we'd like to send to you. If you're out there and you've given your life to Christ, please let us know. You'll see on this video, you'll see our our phone number is, I believe it's on there, and what our Facebook page is Fresh-Fire Ministries, and we would love to you let us know that you gave your life to Christ. Amen. And if you go on our Facebook page, you'll find all the other information, our phone numbers, and our email, and so on, and we'd love to hear from you. We have things we'd like to get in your hands. So if you did do it, please let us know. Amen. Now, regarding our dinner, for those of you that are out there, I guess you're not part of it today. What's that? You can, if you can do that. It says M. Just hit the button that says M. Hallelujah. Anyway, what we're going to do is we're going to be grilling ribeye.